welcome back to my channel. So I have been contemplating how to make the video on free will that was inspired by one of the conversations I had with you guys in the comment sections, where somebody expressed that they felt like they only had 10% of free will because of the way the world works, the complications, enslavements, literally, that other people put onto others makes them feel like they don't really have free will. And I expressed to them that free will is not what the world allows you to do, it's what you allow yourself to do. For me, free will means I can choose to end this video, I can get up, I can walk away, I can use my brain. My brain functions. I have the ability to choose what to do next. I know how to react. Some people believe that we are just creatures reacting to reactions, and though in my 20s I sort of bought into this idea, I proved it wrong by reacting differently to situations in which I had reacted in the past. Now, the universe has recently blessed me because I've been tired, I've been not sleeping as well, I've also been putting a lot of content on OF, and so I've just been feeling a little exhausted because, you know, that shit takes time to look pretty every day. And today I took a little bit of a break while I was editing some photos. For me, editing photos is work, but it's also a break from filming and performing. So I was taking a break by working, and I was watching H3H3's new Frenemies with Trisha. And I made that video just recently about Trisha's possible borderline, because I don't want to diagnose her, but her obvious triggers that happen on the show. And for me, this is a wonderful example of reacting, being a good person, and the ethicism of free will. So I'm going to use it sort of as an example, if you will. On the podcast today, Trisha had a trigger.
I'm not gonna lie, I do think that's a funny idea.
You should totally let my
But I hate the idea of getting Botox, but at the same time, I do acknowledge that it's funny. So
Botox,
I'm torn.
Would be, you know what, Botox is less invasive than lips, because that really does go away
filler.
In 6 weeks.
Not filler, okay. Right?
Get Botox then. Well, that is
You're talking
is
about
filler.
A physical filler? No, I'm not doing that.
It does dissolve, but I get you. Botox will like
Botox,
go away in like,
I feel like
2 months.
Oh my God.
You should get them like right here so your eyebrows are like this. It'd be cool. Because I think you look good. I have a really good girl.
I'm really torn on this because I hate the idea, but it does sound funny. Get a $20,000 bag.
Yeah.
Get some Botox.
Well,
yeah, Ela was watching and she said, why didn't you tell her that she had powder on her lips? I was like, I was staring at it the whole time.
So mean.
On my screen, it just looked like a glint on your lip gloss.
In the beginning, I said you have powder on your lips, but then you didn't get it all off. And the whole episode, I was just staring at.
Can we have Ela as a guest on our podcast?
No.
Why? Because people think like I hate her or she doesn't like me or something. Like, I feel like we need to have like, because like, you know what I mean? Like, I like Ela so much.
She could sit in. Yeah, she could probably sit in.
You just said no. Now you're like,
okay, just a snap judgment. She's busy. Don't talk about Ela. We're cutting this part out. She doesn't want to be talked about.
Are you fucking serious?
I'm serious. We have to cut this.
That's fucking crazy. Like, what's even the point? She's the one we talked about.
Because she doesn't like that you're always bringing her up and saying how she doesn't like you and all this shit, because it's not true and she finds it annoying because she doesn't want people to start thinking that, like, she doesn't actually like you.
Well, she doesn't.
Well,
she doesn't.
Well, whatever. Just cut it out, Dan. I'm serious.
I'll talk about it in mine. I don't care because that's so bullshit. I'm going to stop talking about my personal life altogether then, too.
Okay, whatever.
And then turn the H3 podcast and boring, and it'll just go down the tubes, and no one will care because you guys are not honest and open about shit. So you cut everything out that's personal. It's like, whatever. Wow, you can't even like mention her.
We mentioned her last episode. Because you know what? Leave it in.
No.
Every time.
No, don't.
You
don't
go,
care.
Why does Ela hate me? And she's like, I don't hate her. It's super annoying. Why does she keep saying that?
Then
and
why
it's
doesn't
causing.
She text me? Like, just text,
text
me.
Text you.
Be like, hey, I don't hate you. You know what I mean? Like, but when she's like telling stuff about Moses.
Because I always say.
I don't care.
Yeah, we should cut this. Let's just move on.
No, but like in general, like I'm telling you now, like she needs to text me and just be like, hey, I don't hate you, you know? But it's like she's telling Moses, like, oh, Trisha says this
think,
and that. It's
okay,
like,
this is all off the record, but I think she's just really annoyed by the situation and she just needs some time. The pizza's here.
Wow.
Should we keep doing beauty products?
Whatever you want.
All right, let's do it. What triggered you again? What were we talking about?
Ela being too good for me to talk about on this podcast. Don't even fucking mention her. And she's a fucking queen. Like, don't even fucking mention me on the podcast.
Right, that's
even
why.
Even though I'm a literal podcaster.
Right, that's why.
Cool. And you can talk about
oil, you want to do the oil?
Sure.
The pizza's here, everybody. Woo! The pizza's here. We had a full meltdown while you were gone.
Expect another text from your sister. Oh, my God. I'm not coming back to the house. I'm not.
No.
Moses said, what happened? You know, this is the literal meme where you walk in with the pizza and the room's on fire. This is the literal meme where you come back with the pizza. Oh, my God.
I just left to get pizza.
This is literally... She's really upset because she was saying how Ela doesn't like her.
Ela says, don't talk about me on the podcast. All I said was you should have the guest. He's like, we can't mention Ela. She doesn't want me to talk about, oh, she's too good for a fucking podcast. Even though we were talked about, they never once insulted me at the beginning of the spring. She has a fucking podcast. I brought life to the fucking H3 channel, but oh, Ela's too fucking good to even mention her name. I said nothing bad. I said like, oh, we should have her as a guest or whatever like that. Don't even mention Ela. She doesn't want me talked about. Fucking
okay.
I literally don't care. Literally, I don't want to come back because I really fucking hate her.
So she always making comments about the family and how
I wasn't. That wasn't it. I said, oh, Ela should be a guest on the podcast, and you're like, don't fucking mention Ela. She's the one we talked about. Oh, a fucking queen. You guys can talk about my shit all the time, but her, don't fucking mention her name. Dumb fucking bitch.
Okay.
I think we should just end it, honestly.
Yeah, I think so too.
She's such a fucking bitch.
She's not.
And you are too, and you're a fucking cuck.
You
have no fucking backbone.
All right, you should leave. We'll talk later. Yeah, you should get out.
I am going, but we're not talking later. Fucking bitch, you too. I don't care. Fucking dump me. I couldn't care less. Your family's
not. It's not about dumping.
And for those of you who don't know, separate from the internet memes, a trigger is a medical situation that is occurring. A mental illness has possibly been triggered, causing a reaction. And when that happens, the person who is triggered has now gone into a sort of episode, a mental breakdown. So they can't really almost react appropriately because their brain is just reacting in the most defensive manner possibly. Now, people suspect that Trisha has borderline, and since I have borderline, I do want to speak to this a little bit in relation to free will. Many people feel like when you have a mental illness, you lose your free will. And though I believe this could be true, it has to be observed on a spectrum. I am considered a high functioning borderline, which means I am a person who functions day to day and has very, very few triggers, if none at all. I have yet to have a borderline trigger where I have an episode like Trisha does for over a year now. And a big part of that was because of who I am and also my determination to admit and accept that I am the person with the illness and nobody else has it, and therefore I must be determined to get better. Trisha is under the impression that though she's open to therapy and getting better, she's not determined to get better. And this can be seen through observation. Remember, Trisha's income is based off of her erraticism. The idea that she can be wild and unpredictable is how she makes her money.
Did you really not know you had TP in your asshole? And the answer is no, but you know, I see it now and I kind of just like let it go. The sun was really bright, so like the person filming me, they couldn't tell. To me, it was just such little specks. I thought my booty hole looked nice and clean. I thought it meant like I wipe good, which I do. I use a lot of toilet paper, but yes, I really didn't know. But hey, it turned into a scandal and I monetized it.
So people need to remember that people with mental illnesses will be exploited by industries or themselves to make that dollar bill. If Trisha gets better and she's no longer Trisha, then how will she make her money? So there's a big fear with people who have mental illnesses that who will I be if I get better? We like the devil we know instead of the devil we don't. For myself, I knew who I was when I wasn't being triggered. And when I was triggered in the past, I really was careful about what I shared on the internet. Often when I was in an episode, I would talk bad about my family. And now in observation, and the reason those videos are down is because I realized I was being triggered. And though there are, yes, conversations I could have about how my parents could have done things better, in general, because I was in episodes, I was unable to assess them as good people or bad people.
For me personally, the most difficult thing was worrying about my own sanity as well as my parents. And I know that sounds horrible, but there have been situations, especially if you come from an immigrant family like myself, with the older generations, they tend not to be as hip or up to date with terms, especially with like homosexuality. So, you know, I didn't even talk to my grandfather. I have no clue what he's thinking. But I know a lot of the relatives have found out, and I'm sure some of them are like freaking out and other ones expected it or whatever. But to my parents, who are so Americanized, even if you did come from the crazy sands of Iraq, I expected them to take this whole thing a little bit more sanely, but because it's the whole gay thing started, you know, back for me in eighth grade, and for my parents in high school finding out that I was interested or whatever it was and going through modes, their reaction was so harsh, and it was out of fear and out of love for me and out of fear that they're losing control. And I want parents to know that their kids depend on them. And it's so vital for you guys to understand that as much and as scary as it is for you to find out that you've raised a kid who's different than what you thought they were, it's so much scarier for us who are young, emotional. You know, teenagers, we're freaking weird when we go through stuff like this. And now that I'm 21, you know, I complained a lot to myself that my parents never were the adults. And because they were too busy worrying about other things, and I had to be the adult. I had to watch my sanity. I had to worry about myself. And now that I'm older, I can't complain anymore because I've chosen to be that adult and to be responsible for my own sanity. So mom and dad, I can't complain anymore that you never took reins. And I'm thankful for everything you did in raising me. But it's so vital for my parents and other parents to understand that when your kids are going through this for the first time, and they're talking about these issues with you, it's so important that you take the time to really listen to them.
And this is what happens often with mental illness. But what happens when you don't have a mental illness and you're a completely normal brain and you're observing somebody? How do you tell if they're a good person? Is it if they agree with you, if they look like you, if they go to the same church as you, if they vote like you? Well, I would say no. I would say most of these things don't even matter. I would say the way you can assess if a person is a good person or a bad person is sort of who they are as a whole person. And now what I'm asking the internet to do is not judge someone off a 30-second clip, which I know is asking the impossible. But in order for me to heal from my borderline, in order for me to assess objectively who's a good person and a bad person, I have to acknowledge that I need to know them in a full context. I've known a lot of people over the years on YouTube who, because of mental illness, make horrible mistakes. And I don't judge them wholly based off of those things alone. I take into consideration all of who they are. One of the reasons I don't talk a lot of shit on the people I've known in my past is because I do think they can be redeemed. But I also struggle with a Trisha in my life. I struggle with two of them. I have two Trishas in my life. And though they have both been cut off from my existence and they're not allowed to contact me, this was done because they are in no way, shape, or form interested in getting better. They just want to attack, attack, attack. They're almost both always in perpetual episodes. And if you've seen Trisha switch from normal Trisha to episode Trisha, you can see that it's very, very hard to decide in those moments if this is a good person or a bad person. But when you know mental illness, it's much easier to assess that Trisha, when she's normal, is a good person, and when she's triggered, it becomes a bad person. But not a permanent bad person, because it's just an episode. So people who do not get help with their mental health can become a perpetual bad person by not getting the help that they need. In my level system for a good person, bad person, or observing humanity, these are number ones. Number ones who never get help, number ones who basically cannot even recognize that they themselves are bad people, they stay in perpetual sabotage, they're number ones, they're not functioning. They cause harm onto other people. So I've given examples of like mental illnesses, but let's go to people without mental illnesses. I think people who do not have a mental illness can be bad people, but they're not as common as people would think. And the reason I say this is because most people choose to be good people. Outside of external conflict or alcoholism or drug-induced, you know, paranoia, most people are pretty good. Most people are nice to their families. Most people go about their days. If they weren't, if most people were bad people, the world would be in a much worse place than it is. And objectively, if you zoom out, the world's a pretty good place. So how do you examine a non-mental ill, non-addicted person is a good person or a bad person? Well, this follows through with actions and intent, both being judged at the same time. A lot of people like to say your actions matter or your intent matters, and I think it's both. A lot of people can have bad intent and do good things, or a lot of people can do good things and have bad intent. So you have to weigh these things to dehumanize the human existence, the human experience to something so petty as good or bad is almost doing a disservice. Though I'm not opposed to the language, I'm opposed to how we're assessing it. So one of the things I wrote down in my little phone to remember to talk to you about, was the example of a good person. I'll give you like a little of a bit of an example. I've used this example before, but it was somebody on Patreon had a one-on-one call with me, and they talked to me and they asked me about this example specifically. So, okay, there was an example where I was at my mom's church, and I'm an atheist, but I go to my parents' church. I go to church with my family on occasion to support whatever event's happening. And at the time, we had Middle Eastern people coming to sing, and I wanted to go support my people. So I went to this event with my parents, and the conductor at the church was good at his job, and I went up to compliment him. While I was complimenting him, he told me he was from out of town. He was visiting. His grandfather was sick in the hospital, and I was like, oh, I know where that hospital is. Do you need me to take you there? Do you need directions? And he goes, oh, you would come with me to go see my grandfather? I was like, well, you love your grandfather. You're like openly weeping in front of me. And I know where it is and you're from out of town. So yeah, it's like 15 minutes from here. I can take you there and then just Uber home. And he thought this was very amazing. Like, wow, I can't believe you'd do that. And then weeks later, I realized he thought I was hitting on him. When I told my sister this, she also thought I was hitting on him. She goes, oh, are you into him? And I said, no. And she goes, well, then why are you taking him to the hospital? I was like, because his grandfather's in the hospital and I can. Like, I was just gonna go home that day and play video games and get high, so I can take a break from my life and go help this guy out. Now, the reason I did that is because I believed in that moment, it was the right thing to do given the circumstance and context of the situation. I had the energy, I had a car, or I could Uber, and I had the spoons. I had the energy to take time out of my day. It wouldn't have affected my day at all. It just wouldn't have impacted it that day. Another day, yes, I could have been really tired that day, and then that would have been like, ugh, I gotta go help this guy. But no, for that day, it was no big deal, so I offered. Why not? Now, some people told me, wow, you're a really good person for doing that. And I just thought to myself, well, I'm a really good community member. I don't know about whole person based off of one situation, but I will say, I think it's a good community member thing to do. But I'm heavily impacted by my local community. I believe we should look out for our local community. I take bread to my neighbors. I'm making my neighbors scarves this year. I try to do the things that make me happy as a person, so I'm acting in my positive selfishness. And on top of that, I'm acting in accordance to my values, which says as a good community member, I should fill a need. See a need, fill a need. I can do that. I can't do it always. I'm not obligated to do it. I don't think it's my obligation to do it, because that's kind of going the extra mile. I think as a community member, our basic obligation to each other is not to kill each other. That's my basic belief, is we should not kill each other. Now, with that said though, some people asked me if I was choosing to do this because I knew of the social reward and therefore it wasn't an altruistic action, or whether it was altruistic. I don't believe in altruism. I do not believe humans do anything out of the goodness of their heart with no return. It's a sort of the Randian part of my brain, where I do believe every action is a selfish action. I just think there are positive selfish actions and negative selfish actions. So my two Trishas, the Trishas I have in my life, they're so negative. Their negative selfishness is so impactful that they have caused damage to hundreds of people in their immediate circles, to the point where I can no longer justify their physical interaction in my existence. Versus somebody like even myself who struggles with borderline, who has worked to get better. I have seen my family go from Brittany, we can't have you around, to now Brittany's in the inner circle again because Brittany worked on herself. And I think that was so important. It's a mutual understanding of when you are struggling, you still have to be held accountable. Now, the second part of this is the reactionary more responsible than the perpetrator? So as an example, some people felt like Trisha, because she was the perpetrator, she called Ela the B word and the C word. And even me, who says those words on a regular, can't even think about saying it towards Ela, because I love this woman so much. She's such a good person that I know hearing it must have hurt her feelings so much. But objectively, I also know Trisha doesn't mean them, that she's being triggered, but that does not stop the impact of those words from hurting people. So Trisha is responsible for the pain she caused. Now, I think Ethan is the example of somebody who is what I want in culture and in society to a large extent in this situation alone, because Ethan and I definitely could have conversations about his fear over COVID. But with that said, in this situation, Ethan remains calm, supportive, questionable, tries to hold her accountable, is very understanding. He says, I think you're going through something right now. While Trisha's freaking out, anyone else, everyone in the comments was like, oh, fuck Trisha, fuck Trisha. But Ethan sees the humanity of Trisha, and with compassion, which means to suffer with, has the patience to stay with her. to stand his ground and defend his wife, but also to understand that nothing that's being said here really matters. And that's the issue with mental illness in this country, is that we talk about how we need to save the world and save the homeless population and save all these people who are struggling, but the people that you need to save are the Trishas of the world, because everyone else, myself included, even though I have borderline, I did it. I didn't need the world to save me. I did it. So that's the thing. Normal, regular, functional people, they just do it on their own. Everyone else who needs someone to be there either asks society to do it, and then society has to take on that burden, or in Trisha's situation, it's Ethan. Ethan is Trisha's world. That's why Trisha gets so hurt during those interactions where Trisha says, I think you want to fuck me. And Ethan goes, what? You're crazy. That's the thing. Borderline is sort of that fear of abandonment, being loved for who you really are, and then getting defensive and running away when people betray you. And as somebody who has had so many girls lie about her, as a person who just like did not understand as a youth why people were so cruel, and I took it to heart, my abandonment is completely directly associated with the fact that I came out as a queer kid when I was younger, and I was rejected for that until I was then embraced for like who I am now. So I understand, right, in hindsight, why my brain did what it did. But Trisha and a lot of people in the world, they don't do that. They don't sit down and think, what did I do? What is my life? What is it? Because it's your brain that is processing it the way it is. I didn't ask for this. My parents didn't mean to cause it. Nothing like that was ever done maliciously or on purpose. It's just, it is the way that it happens. So for me, when I think of who's more responsible, the predator, perpetrator, or the victim, or person handle getting the backlash, I put it on the person who's able to be the bigger person to a large extent. So Ethan takes the responsibility of this situation by remaining calm. He could have sunk down to her level. He could have become just as petty. He could have called her fat or ugly or white trash, or he could have gone really hard on her. He could have picked every insecurity Trisha's made clear she has and caused it to go worse, but he didn't. He chose to be the bigger person in that situation and tried to, to the best of his ability, because he's still human, calm the situation down. I think about this in our larger understanding of what is free will. In some situations, some people would say Trisha doesn't have free will because Trisha has a mental illness. But I have a mental illness, and I guarantee you I have free will. When I'm in an episode, everything feels heightened, and the most cruel idea of a person comes to the forefront of my mind. I lack compassion, and compassion means to suffer with. So when you lack compassion, you forget what it's like to be that person. Now, there must be context in which sane adults can have conversations that would otherwise trigger mentally ill adults. As an example, I can have a conversation now objectively about the way I look, about my weight, about my politics, about every insecurity I've ever had, and not get triggered, not get offended, because I understand that there was a time in my life in which my brain could not process these conversations without being triggered. Well, now, because I've healed and work constantly on keeping my healing maintained, I can have reasonable conversations without freaking out. So people need to understand, when you're triggered, you are the crazy person, and the rest of the world has to deal with you. And even in those moments, there is a spectrum of free will occurring. And so we have to examine what it means to have choice while making our decisions. You cannot be a person who claims you are an adult with the ability to consent and you don't believe in free will. You can't say you're an adult who has the ability to consent except when you're an asshole because you're being triggered, and therefore you get just like an exception to your bad behavior. Your mental illness is never an excuse for your bad behavior. It is only an explanation. So the rest of us don't have to take it personal. Because here's the thing, when you take things personal, when they're not meant to be, like Trisha does here, where she is literally infiltrating, and a lot of people with BPD can do this. I was quite the opposite with mine, which is why I think I was considered high functioning, because I actually took the opposite, a stereotypical borderline symptom of taking everything personal. I assumed nothing was personal, which wasn't helpful either, because some things were personal. And I just thought the best of everyone. So nope, can't be that. And then I would just push away if people wanted to get close, but I wouldn't push away just because someone was mean to me. And so I think I also have a hard time when I'm observing this, understanding that like when people think of borderlines, they're thinking of Trisha. And that's also hard for people like me because we don't fall on this spectrum. But it also allows me to communicate with you about the loopholes and what is mental illness and what is free will. Hold on, let me look at my notes. Oh, do we? Okay, so do we have free will? Good person. So in order for us to sort of examine what is free will, I think we have to decide, what is a human? How does our brain function? And what is it capable of doing? So let's say you're on the spectrum. Like, I have a lot of people who are on the autism spectrum who watch me. Hi, hello guys. And everyone has a different spectrum. Some people who follow me completely do not understand what I'm saying. And sometimes when they try to speak for me, make things worse because they completely do not understand what's going on. But they think they know what's going on. And because their brain processes things the way they do, they sometimes make it harder for me. But I just talk to them, we clear it up, and we move on. Now, this is me taking it upon myself to look at them as a human and to remember that their brain is processing information at a completely different speed and on a spectrum. Because then I have some people who are autistic in my audience who don't do this to me, who literally don't make my life harder. Now, I've worked with people who've worked with people with kids with autism who are nonverbal. They throw chairs, they're violent. And so some people have to question, where does free will come in and where does your brain, your vessel, stop you from having the ability to consent? And I think a lot of it, in order to even have this conversation about autism, you have to make sure you're not going to get triggered, because some people get defensive, right? Not all autistic people are like this. Well, of course they're not like this. All people are not like anything. All white people aren't like one way. All black people aren't like one way. All autistic people aren't one way. So when we have these conversations, we have to acknowledge that I'm obviously only speaking to the people. My sentences have to apply to the people I'm speaking about. So I cannot be in denial that some borderlines, especially untreated borderlines like Trisha, allegedly like Trisha, are a mess. They are borderline dangerous versus somebody like me who's worked on it. I'm not a threat to anybody because I'm not a threat to myself. And that's sort of the key component here. We think because Trisha makes money, she's fine, but money does not cure mental illness, and money alone does not bring you happiness or joy, which is why I don't think ill of the rich, because being rich doesn't signify anything to me except you don't have to think about rent. Good for you. But it doesn't help me understand if you're a good person or a bad person or understand the world. I don't know how you got there necessarily. So when we think of compassion and we think of free will, we must first examine ourselves. How well do you exercise free will? How well do you categorize yourself? Are you a person who says, I have a mental illness and so you need to be aware of my issues? Because right now what you're doing is stopping other people from exercising their free will to their joy. Because now they have to worry about you. And in turn, you're not allowing yourself to hold yourself accountable to exercise true free will, which is outside of the bounds of your mental illness. If you're a functioning human being and then you get hit in the head with a hammer and you're in a coma, like, how much free will can you exercise? If you're a person who never gets help with their mental illness and you get triggered, well, in an episode, how much free will can you possibly have? Well, that's debatable. That confuses me too. Because when I'm triggered, if I get triggered and if it's really bad, I go straight to the shower and I think of ways to kill myself. And I think this is too much and I don't want to deal with this and I don't want to do this. Now, again, I haven't been triggered since I think September of 2019 was my last, September, October of 2019. And it was after that very big and public stalker situation where I had a stalker and it was awful and the internet was coming for me and claiming I was a predator and a groomer because a stalker convinced people that's who I was. So I had to literally fix my borderline, exercise my free will, and examine who I was based off of who I was, not who the internet said I was. So then I had to assess, I'm a good person, right? I'm not a bad person. And so I had to shut the world out and I had to remember that I live within my values. When you don't have values, it's very easy to let your mental illnesses control you. It's very easy to let your skin color or politics of your skin color dictate who you are. We are not these things. These things are a part of us. It's very different. Who you are as a person, sitting in your room, separate from any of the world's judgment, that's the person I want to learn about. That's the person that is supposedly, at least in my head, the person I want to know before I marry them. Who is that person? because I want to know everything about you. Now, if you're just a person who sits at home and never considers the impact you have on the world or who you are alone in your room, you might be just repeating a sort of script that other people have given you. This isn't the Truman Show. You have free will. You have an ability to live outside of the script of society and culture. And the script is not the patriarchy. The script is not white cis men. The script is not trans. The script is not gay. The script is cultural. So acknowledge where you live, acknowledge what the outer script is, and decide in which way are you going to live the script when it's appropriate, like in public settings or community settings. And then when you're in your small niche communities, in your home, how are you going to exercise your individuality? Remember, and I said this on my live show on Patreon, please join us if you would like for a dollar or more. In last live show for Patreon, you can go rewatch it. We were talking about the script, the social script, and how someone said that I think a level six is somebody who doesn't live in the script and still lives in public. But no, that's just called an asshole. You have to follow a social script that exists in communities to keep everything cohesive. That's just called having good manners. The reason my philosophy only has five levels is because the ones are the people who have free will and refuse to use it. You refuse. They're not people with disabilities, like mental disabilities. They're not people who literally can't. They're people who know they have it and they refuse to use it. Versus the twos come in a large spectrum. People who can be babies, and the best they can do is what a baby's brain can do. People who are growing adults but don't have the intelligence higher than a three-year-old, they're not number ones. They're not useless. They have a function. And the function to the best of their ability is that. And they have a very important play in society. And the twos can be people who have success, who are presidents, who have money and wealth, and are still sort of conflicted about who they are in public and who they are at home. And it's not about being secretive. It's not about, you know, Trisha talked about that in the podcast where she was like, Ela doesn't want us to talk about her family issues because she's fake and not transparent. There is an appropriate amount you should share with the world, and there is an appropriate respect you should have your family by keeping things private. And Trisha doesn't know that line. And a big part of that is because she doesn't have values. If you do not know your values, if you do not truly believe what is right or wrong or what is good, you will not be consistent. So for me, free will is not, men are born free. I don't care if you're born into slavery, your dignity as a human is your ability to have a consciousness, to know, oh, I'm a human, and somebody's enslaving me physically, but mentally and spiritually, I have free will. And you can use those wits about you to get out of those situations or to fight for liberation. But the physical restraints anyone has on me will never dictate my individuality, my free will, or how good of a person I am. I spoke to somebody recently who sort of was concerned that environment creates the person, but I believe the person creates the environment. You ever meet really poor people who are in the worst situations of their lives, and they're the most wonderful, wholesome, beautiful people you've ever met? They have every reason to be cynical and awful about the world, but they're not. And it's because they have a spirit about them, a personhood. No matter how bad it got in my household, no matter how bad the economy crashed in 08, my parents lost everything, my parents always fought harder, kept us positive, never let their kids, they never let the badness of the world dictate their spirit. And I saw that in my parents, and I learned that from my immigrant background, that no matter how bad the world was around us, we had to be grateful for even the grain of rice we could eat at the end of the day. And so they exercise their free will to understand that they have a choice in a moment to react how they can. So the world was acting horribly hostile towards them, and they chose their free will to act as a good person instead of just emotionally reacting. And I think that's just so important. I think it's so important that we acknowledge that we have the ability to choose how to react. And yes, it can feel petty and wonderful to clap back and to throw shade and to fucking act like we're all 12-year-olds. And I know the internet is primarily young people, but listen to me when I say this, you're not always gonna be young. And you're eventually gonna have to grow up and face the world for what it is. And the world is not billboards, it's not talking points, it's not even Fox fucking News or CNN. Real life is, what are you doing as a neighbor? What are you doing as a citizen? What are you doing through COVID? How are you reacting when things get bad? I wanna know who a person is when things get bad, because that tells me more about them than anything else. And the problem is in America, people have it so good here that we often don't get to have those situations occur, which is why COVID is very interesting for me, because it kind of showed me what people were really like when things don't go according to plan. How do people react? It's easy to be there for somebody when everything's good. And that's what that's my concern with society, especially with young people, when they say things like, we need to help people with mental illnesses. You can start with Trisha Paytas. She's got a pretty bad one. And when conservatives think about mental illness, they think about Trisha, because that's what a lot of us have to deal with. So for Ethan to have the patience and the compassion to be there for her as a friend, that's a friend. And it's not everyone's job to do that for everyone in their life. I removed the two Trishas from my existence because I tried my best. But if they're not willing to get better, then they're not worth my time. And Trisha gets compassion from Ethan because in her weird way, she's been trying. And if you can't see that, then you're not really seeing her. But whether or not she continues to get better, and she will have setbacks, right? That's gonna be up to them. They're not our worry. Oh, my camera stopped. So Trisha and Ethan aren't us, but they are examples of what many of us are facing in our own lives. So I guess when we think about free will and what it means to have it, you must first accept that you have it. And I do, I accept that I have it. I have a choice in how I act and what I do with my life. And no one gets to tell me otherwise. I will die for my values because I believe in them. And I know that because I've starved for them. I will literally never do anything I don't want to do. Like, people questioned me having an OnlyFans and questioned whether or not this was good for women and was it objectifying. And to be honest, I don't know if it's good for women, but it's good for me and I like it and I like the work that I do there. And it's absolutely not for kids, it's 18 plus. But it is what I like to do. And I will never do anything there that I don't want to do. I don't care if somebody offers me $15 million. I would rather starve. And I know that about myself because I have. People have offered me horrendous amounts of money. And I just say, no, thank you. I'm not ready yet. And that's just what it is. Maybe that's being old or maybe that's being raised the way I was. But there's a lot of people in culture today who say they have values, but the moment it's tested, well, it's clear you don't. And so my challenge to you today is, do you have values? Do they surround free will or the idea that somebody else controls you? And where do you go from there? Thanks for watching this rant. I really hope you enjoyed it. It was a hard one to follow. And I really hope that we can have a really good discourse after this. Comment sections down below. Follow me on OF if you're interested for adult content. Patreon if you're interested for the podcast, YouTube side of the work that I do. And thanks for watching. Have a great day. Bye.
You don't need negativity in your life. So shoo the negativity away. Shoo it away. And invite just, you know, love and peace into your life. And logic. Use your logic. I know it's so easy to go on our feelings at this time, but dudes, listen to me. Try to be as logical as possible. It's gonna help you get through a lot. I mean, be in tune. Cry. I love to cry. I think I feel so better after I cry. I like watching sad movies when I need to cry. Like P.S. I Love You. Ugh, I bawl every time during that movie. It makes me feel better. It's like my cope. Or, I, you know, take a bat and slam something. I have anger issues. Anyway.